Uno, dos, one, two, tres, cuatro.
Come on, come on! Hear ye, hear ye! For those who are having up in the air, while the flames are still hot, show those dangerous jokes for a little jungle.
Yes, right!
Thank you, thank you. Here's the band, here's the one that plays. And this, my friends, is the start of this beloved day. Welcome
to the party. Let that be a double.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, dogs and cats and mice and rats, welcome to this wonderful celebration of our dear friend and brother, Jerry Lee. We're going to be having a lot of fun. We're going to be paying a lot of tributes. We're going to be talking about Jerry throughout the day and evening. But let's get this thing off right. Ladies and gentlemen, a big, warm welcome for the Blue Moonies doing Blue Moon.
Traveling solo down 75, end of the year, and I'm barely alive. Papa said, come over and stay for a while. We're in your troubles, tribulations, and trials. Life on the land of Maker Seal. Difference between a monkey and a chimpanzee. Living on the land you won't ever die. Primate research isn't what it's about. I said, how do I get the help? Follow the driver, go straight up to heaven and stop at the light. Round around the corner, you'll be there soon. Take a left at the sign of the blue moon. Doing inside, he said, I hop on in and we'll go for a ride. Swing from the high to the highest tree. On my front door, I got the box set. David, take him over and bring your guitar. We'll tell a few stories and sit by the fire. Sooner or later, I will see you tonight. You go through my yard just to get to the job.
I said, how do I get the help on the drive? Go straight up to heaven and stop in the light. Right around the corner, you'll be there soon. Take a look at the sign of the blue moon.
Thank you.
the light. Right around the corner, you'll be there soon. Take a look at the sign. Up the blue moon.
Down Scott Street,
everybody had
a rabble road. You can find some more people there, I am told. If you take a little walk down the Bellamy Lane, they got a new
kind of
from the human race. They got guys in blouses throwing pies and eyes, and if you listen a little closer, hear the children's cries.
Everybody let the head down.
It's happening.
Everybody saw the sunshine. I said, how do I get the help out of the drive? Straight up to heaven and stop in the line. Round around the corner, you'll be there soon. Take a look at the sign.
Up the blue moon. Up the blue moon. Up the blue moon.
My lovely bride of coming on, 40 years here in September, and I met Jerry Lee 30 years ago this coming March, April, I guess. We had chosen a unique path in our lives, my wife and I, in that we found ourselves doing what we believed was a mission from God. And we kind of volunteered ourselves to go into this mission, kind of a dangerous mission, and a mission that caused us to sacrifice everything we owned for the sake of good. And I won't go into the details, but we believed in the mission, and a lot of you know the mission. And we thought we succeeded. And then we were threatened, and our lives kind of collapsed around us, and we had to escape. We escaped Pennsylvania and headed to the wilds of the West and found ourselves on the Rio Grande near Taos, New Mexico. When we had chosen that mission, we truly felt that we were being sent by God. But then things kind of crumbled around us and nothing was fulfilled. And we were left at our wits' end. And we didn't know where else to go. And we were broke, and we were lonely, and we were sad, and we were scared as hell. And we prayed hard that night for God to send us some kind of a sign that things were going to be okay. And we stayed up looking over that Rio Grande Gorge and looking at those stars and listening to that wind coming up that canyon. And we held each other's hands, and we went to sleep pretty discouraged. Early that morning, Joy gets up out of our little camping van and goes out to go pee, and she comes in and she says, honey, there's a circus outside. And I say, what? And there's a kid skateboarding out there, and there's this beautiful blonde lady with a monkey. And maybe that's a sign, I don't know. Well, God answered my prayer that day by introducing me to Jerry Lee and Jane and Jamin and Jonathan Lee, and through them, the rest of this fabulous, timeless family. As a result of that meeting, not only did we eat that night, not only did we gain strength, not only did we look to the future and find a new vision for ourselves that served people and caused people to smile, it lasted. And I'm still a professional clown full-time today. And I would have never been that if I hadn't met these wonderful people. Jerry used to say, we're bringing miles of smiles. And trust me, with this crew, all of you around us, we've brought them, brothers and sisters. We've brought them. Later in our life together, we had the great privilege of laying on the mesa in East Texas near Abilene, laying on our backs and watching the stars and trying to come up with a name for a beautiful, beautiful baby girl. Well, as you know, reggae is kind of part of our culture here, and jamming with Bob Marley, who kept playing over and over and over again. We felt we played with many names for the girl. Finally, we gave up. Next morning, this young lady here was named Jamin. Can we welcome her to this party? I also got the privilege of when she was born, she was stuck in a hospital in Abilene and they wouldn't let her out. Armed guards and everything. Remember? Isn't that how it went? And we had to break into the hospital and rescue her from that hospital. It was awful. I was just told a while ago that the photos from that event don't quite match our story, but I'm going to go with the former. Jerry challenged us to address our own spirituality. And he always questioned that. He always said, well, what do you mean? What's God? Whose God are you? Which God are you worshiping? Where do you get this guidance? And in those early days, a great poet we knew came up with these lines. And Jerry kind of twisted this into these words. We call God Jah, not like before, when we called God, God, and nothing more. And from those words was born really a lifestyle of intense spirituality and outreach to all the people that Jerry met. And it lives to this very day. I see it all around us today. Jerry lived a full and ominous and wonderful life. He affected us all. He affected us in so many ways that guess what? We got to challenge his spirituality as well. And for that, I'm really very, very thankful. A few nights ago, Jerry was leaving us, and he had quite the exit. For one thing, he died at 11:11. 11:11. And as many of you know, the Benevolent Order of Scurrilous Monks holds those numbers sacred. Wooly bully! He left our side with two beautiful women at his side. He left us with a beautiful, wonderful brother at his feet. He left us with a monkey on his lap. And boy, I can't imagine any other way to go. Think of yourself with them that evening. Jerry's laying there. Everyone's around him. His monkey's on his lap. And he just sits straight up in bed. And looks at everyone and looks at Higgs, his brother, in the eye. And all of a sudden, there was a clarity. He wasn't just aware, he was there. Higgs said, I love you, brother. He laid down and he was gone. Well, that's the way he left his life as far as his spiritual side. The way he left his life physically was just as entertaining. Everyone started applauding immediately as soon as he laid down. Like, good job, Jerry. Okay. Someone, and I'm not going to say who because it could haunt them for the rest of their life, placed a clown nose on this poor dead man's body. David started singing or playing with the kazoo this song. You know, in the old days, when Jerry and the crew bought this, and David and Ray bought this place, you know who they bought this from? A man named Neil Young. Yeah, not that Neil Young, but still kind of cool to be able to buy your property from Neil Young. Well, when the crematory people came to pick him up and they brought him out with his nose and singing this song and clapping, the lady's name who came to pick him up was named June Carter. So you gotta figure, he bought this place from Neil Young and June Carter picked him up when he bought the farm. We miss you, Jerry, and we love you so much. Let's give him a big round of applause. Let's go and continue. We have some people who like to say some words about Jerry and talk about him and talk what they meant to his life. And first up is Ray. Ray, come on up.
This is my newspaper column that's going to be in tomorrow morning's High Springs Herald. And I have to give Brother Higgs credit for the idea for this essay. Something he said in passing the other day when we were beginning to plan for this event. Let us not observe a moment of silence for Jerry Lee. If there was anything that my longtime friend and land partner hated, it was silence. The moment when the grand show of life came to a grinding halt. Rather, let us prepare for the next act, the next bit of comic shtick, the next big trick to wow the crowd. Start big, finish big, keep them interested in between. These were the words Jerry Lee lived by. He was the consummate showman, Jerry Lee the monkey man, Elfie the friendly ape, Papa Dollar of the Old West Medicine Show, Tico Manley, Ross Papa of the Traveling Gypsy Show. Jerry was part performing artist, part poet, part ringleader, and all clown. He was the trickster, the huckster, the salesman, the snake oil salesman, the teller of tales. He was one of the world's foremost advocates of clown terrorism. Those random acts of inappropriate frivolity perpetrated by hit-and-run militant humorists. One way of looking at the life of Jerry Lee would be to see it as a six-decade escape from normalcy. Jerry didn't do normal. He did unusual, surprising, astonishing, challenging, but not normal. Jerry was more inclined to spend an afternoon cooking up a bigger and better balloon liftoff than more mundane activities like balancing his checkbook or managing his retirement accounts. Jerry left that kind of work to other people. He was more drawn to the show business of daily existence, more comfortable in a clown nose than in a suit. In a way, you could say he was constantly in search of the next big high. He lived for the exhilaration of the moment. Life was a rush, a madcap race to the finish, punctuated with magic, theater, spectacular feats of daring do, tricks with whips, balloon animals, eating fire, lying on prickly beds of nails. And all of it capped off with a rousing round of applause. Jerry lived hard and fast, but that was his nature. His addictive personality and habits were no secret to anyone who knew him. They were not a thing to emulate, but a thing to understand and forgive. He could no more live the straight and narrow than he could join a country club or apply for membership in the Elks. The world was Jerry's stage. He performed at fairs and festivals all over the United States. He organized balloon liftoffs in his adopted home of Costa Rica. He, along with various assortments of friends, staged impromptu street circus shows in out-of-the-way Costa Rican villages. Jerry was always the instigator, the grand supporter of all things community. He pushed the rest of us to greater heights of community spirit.
Thank you.
Jerry always said, the creation of our Alachua artist retreat, the Blue Moon, which he and David Ballard and I pulled off back in 1990, was the best thing we ever did. After 19 years of campfire sing-ins and New Year's celebrations, it's hard to disagree. Yeah. So here's to Jerry Lee, who followed his own path. He was the last of the great beatnik vaudevillian nonconformists. When they came to get Jerry's body, we sent him off with his clown nose on, a beer under his arm, and a cigarette tucked behind his ear. And we all wore our clown noses as well and hummed circus tunes on kazoos. Jerry didn't live his life like a normal person. There's no reason why he should go out like one. Therefore, let us not observe a moment of silence for Jerry Lee. Instead, let us create a loud and joyful noise. Let us cheer and laugh and howl and cry and blow on noisemakers and play circus tunes on kazoos. Let us raise a great cacophony of inappropriate, silly sounds, but no silence. Pregnant pause for comic effect, perhaps. After all, the essence of all comedy is, wait for it, timing. But no silence. 2 days before he died, Jerry somehow found the energy to direct all the relatives and friends who were hanging around to help ease the monkey man into the next world. In one last performance of the Old West show, he was giving instructions and pointing and making it up on the fly. There was much laughter and frivolity and, in the end, applause. That was Jerry Lee. He started big, finished big, and in between, he kept us all interested.
Jerry had a lot of angels in his life. He had a lot of wonderful people that had his back, as you all know, through many, many trials and tribulations. In the waning moments of his life, he had the privilege of having my beautiful daughter travel with him to Costa Rica and be here through his treatments. And through the final waning moments of his life, he had a wonderful, beautiful angel. And we'd like for her to speak to us now. Kristen?
Yeah.
Up here today and read a poem of the semi-well-renowned Johnny Walker that kind of epitomized Jerry's passion, his drive, his motivation, his unyielding thrust for life. And then I had written notes on my hand, on pieces of paper, tried to remember them in my mind, but really, you know, they're just paper. How do you put in words what Jerry Lee was? I can't. It's part of me. And I am so much better for that. But the defining moment for this shift in my presentation here today was about 5:20 a.m. this morning. You'll appreciate this, Jay. I wake up, monkey at my face, shaking. And I was low blood sugar, for those of you non-diet. And there's another one out here somewhere that I forgot where I left it now. 42. And it was a fast 42. It was a falling 42. So get up. I eat a banana. I eat an apple. I ate a spoonful of peanut butter, and I see headlights pulling in the driveway. So I said, that must be the clowns, of course. And I walk out, peanut butter breath. And greet them and tell them, no, you're not living in the shed. You're in the other hovel. And that struck me because just hours earlier talking to a mutual friend of ours, I said, God damn, Nixie, what the fuck do you say? What do you say? She's like, well, his spirit will be there, and da-da-da-da. I was like, I don't feel him. He's gone. I don't feel him. And Mama and I went to sleep, and about right at that moment where you're almost asleep, monkey's comfortable, something crashed in the house. And, Mama's sitting up, looking. I said, okay, I'll investigate that tomorrow. And then the clowns drive in hours later, and it was cosmically, karmically correct, and ultimately imperfectly impeccable. Jah guide and protect Jerry Lee. Wooly bully, amen.
This is somebody that needs really not an introduction, but I'll go ahead and give him one. Brother Higgs.
As I'm often said, I'm not a professional, like these guys. But
professional pecker checker.
Hello. we've been, Mama, calm down. It's okay, Mama, it's okay. It's okay. I don't know if y'all saw that, but Kristen took James, Flamin' James, top hat, and returned it to her just now. My charge is to kind of talk about the early days. When we were kids, he was organizing. He put us in wagons and raced us around the yard. All the little kids would be in the wagons, and the big kids would be pushing us. He would take us and play hide and seek with a twist. That twist was, if the big guys caught you, they tied you up and left you. You think monkeys hanging in trees was the first time there was hangings in trees related to Jerry Lee? You got it all wrong. Poor Tim Goodson ended up in the doghouse and didn't return that night, and his parents got a little worried. When they finally knocked on our door and says, anybody seen Tim? Oh, shit. I think I left him tied up in the doghouse. Of course, Jerry just said that to himself and went and freed Tim and let Tim come home on his own. Now, if that had anything to Tim growing up and being a policeman, I'm not sure. Jerry also, from the earliest years that I can remember, I was 7 years younger, he always took time out for me, and he helped raise me. And one of the things we always did together was play strategy games. And in his early days, even though his son Brett Favre might not remember this, that he enjoyed organizing football games with the kids, but he didn't do it like anybody else where you just go out and throw the football around and you try to play the game. He kept stats, and he would write it all down, and he'd keep us going for a season. And he did the same thing with baseball. And then he started inventing these games that we would play. One that I remember was a detective game, and he drew up these cards and had descriptions and all this kind of stuff, and you had to figure out who committed a particular crime. Later on, they invented this game called Clue, but it wasn't very, it was very much similar, but not near as sophisticated as what Jerry came up with. He also invented a game that was about football. We played football game and on paper and stuff. And again, they came out with a game a few years later called The Quarterback. The game was almost to a T what Jerry had invented years before. But Jerry's was much more sophisticated. And later on, he invented he liked doing these war games, strategy games, colonization. And then I think all of our favorite, just called The Game. The Game! The Game. But we would spend hours playing The Game. Days, weeks. And he invented this stuff. He had this all in his brain. He was always creating, even as a kid. And then I'm going to read you something. I'm actually going to read you a couple things, but this thing I'm going to read you right now came and gives a history of how the Rainbow Traveling Show first came into being. And it's from one of his first cohorts, Paul Nienover, also lovingly known as Sticky the Clown.
Sticky!
Wow. Sticky couldn't come with us. We actually tried to get him to catch a ride with Rio Blue and Jim Bynum or Joe Dixon from Houston, but they couldn't. He just couldn't make it happen. So Sticky sent me an email instead.
Love it.
Pigs, I appreciate you reading this story I would like to share. If Papa Spirit is indeed looking in on this occasion, and we all know it is, he is saying, a dollar short and a day late, yeah. Rusta Newts, for not showing up. I still have the note he put on my bus after Huey and Sticky were late for our rendezvous. After all, we were abducted by strippers from evil people. I met Jerry in Florida in the early 70s. He was traveling in a van with a beautiful woman selling tapestries and other things from Central America. I met him through JC, a close friend of his. You reckon that's any kin to that JC you know, Randy, so well? Where I was staying, we had some good times in Florida. He later told me he was a fugitive from a bad drug rap. He said he was going to turn himself in and get this fear of the man off him and serve his time. We rode each other, and I ended up in Texas.
Hallelujah.
He was telling me about his vision of traveling show of sorts with animals and circus acts and other animals. I told him to come to Texas when he gets out. He was an iron worker, and Texas was booming with construction. Jerry came to Texas and brought another beautiful woman, the Flaming Jane, with him, who is still beautiful.
Yeah.
Opa. Opa. They worked and saved their money and bought a Suburban. He cut a hole in the top and welded a VW square box back on the top. And Jay, brother Jay, and myself were there that time. They were ready to hit the road of the unknown and live life on the edge. When they came back the next year, the truck was all painted up like an art car, and Rainbow Traveling Show was painted on the side.
Hallelujah.
Alfie the Ape and Flamin' Jane were born. They did show and tells at preschools with different animals, including their first monkey, Mama.
Yay,
Mama.
After a few years, Jerry wanted a bigger show. He wanted more acts. Music, theater, vaudeville, and more. Then came Papa Dalla, the bullshit whip artist. Flamin' Jane added sequins and bikini to her wardrobe and the Lady of Steel act. They wanted me, Paul, to be part of the show. Then their next trip to Texas, Jerry handed me official papers from the Rainbow Traveling Show. They were titled Paul's Plan. If I still had those I still have those original papers. My friend Huey came along with me, so I'm finally going to be part of the traveling show. This is an aside. When Huey and Paul joined the Rainbow Traveling Show, they had to buy into the show. This valley right here, this sailcloth, is one of three sailcloths that they used to buy into the show. Also at that time, he had, this is again an aside for me, also at that time, they had a friend of them that was a professional circus guy come out and watch the show. And after doing it, Jerry said, "Well, what do you think?" I said, "Jerry, your greatest asset is your audacity to perform." So, back to Paul's statement. We grew to 8 people. It was a great team. Traveling the back roads of America was the theme. Jerry's philosophy was reality. That place where reality and fantasy come together. It really worked in the smaller towns. We would roll into these little towns and the people didn't know what to think. Some would come running out cheering, and some would hide. Then we would put on our costumes and parade around town, juggling, passing out balloon sculptures, showing the animals, and barking out when the next show would start. Showtime! Showtime! Step right up! We brought the fantasy to their reality, and they embraced it. Once they talked to us and felt our hospitality and saw the show, they would say, "We hope you can come back next year," and we would. The smell of the crowd, the roar of the grease paint, the rainbow traveling show. Sometimes the show went as smooth as a violin sonata, and sometimes it was like a floor of marbles on a ballet stage. Who could forget the time that the Swami Yogananda really walked on hot coals? Or Sticky's first time on the stage, solo, introducing the show, just froze like a stone, as if everyone in the audience had a head of Medusa. And from backstage, I remember there were fruits coming out from backstage. And finally, Jerry pulled his cane out and grabbed Sticky by the neck and pulled him back on stage. Now, Sticky left that part out, but I remember that well. After about a three-year run, we all went our own ways. I learned a lot from the show, and I went on to do Sticky the Clown for many years after the show at festivals, parades, Mardi Gras, and music festivals. The show was internationally unknown and totally unfamous. But when we showed up in those back road towns, we were the only show, and to them, we were famous and definitely now known. There are some things in my life I would change if I could do them over again, but meeting Jerry Lee, Papa, the times we had, and being part of the traveling show, all the people I've crossed paths with, and the wisdom I've received isn't one of those things. Peace and much love in our hearts. Out. And Sticky ends with a question. Did anyone capture the dying, gasping breath of Papa Dollar in the Elixir of Life bottle? And of course the answer is yes! The hell with Jesse James, we got Rod Papa now! And also have a note here from Dose Jerry. I know many of you here on the Blue Moon know Jerry and Dose. Well, Dose called the other night. And in fact, it was last night. He called and we put him on speakerphone. He wanted to know how many people were around the campfire. And there was only one answer. Dose! 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 So, to Jerry Lee, I'm here in Coweta with our friends, and we offer up a toast to you on a great journey to Sipapa. Sipapoo! Mr. George will be there to show you around and burn a smoke, along with a host of old friends waiting to hear your stories. I know you'll do 20 minutes when the light comes on. After 22 years of shows through times of laughter, good times, disappointments, and personal ups and downs, I got to know you better than anyone. But I loved you anyway. For those who didn't get to know you, it wasn't because you didn't try. Thank you for being my friend. Thank you for introducing me to Costa Rica. I know you'll show me around again when I get to Sipapoo. Your loving other brother, Dose. Yeah. love you, brother.
How's everybody doing? You okay? A lot of people have left-hand men and right-hand men. For the last 9 years, Wayne has been here on the property being Jerry's right-hand man. We need a big old round of applause and some words from Mr. Wayne.
Well, I gotta say, I still remember to this day the first time I ever saw Jerry Lee. I was 14 years old. I'd just been invited back to the campground with this cute girl. But once we got back to the campground and I saw the campfire and I saw Jerry Lee and Ted King and all his cohorts telling their stories, I knew right then at that moment that I had to be a part of what he was doing right there. Just the way he captured that crowd, even of his friends, you know, to be able to capture people right here who you know and love. And he could do it to anybody, and we all know that. And he's been such a great influence in my life and everybody here. And the moment I was the most impressed with Jerry was towards the end when he kept it together so well. He still led us through everything until the last moment. He pulled us together. You know, Higgs had a great part in it, and Kristen too. But you guys know, he led us through every second of that and made sure we took care of it. And then when he was done, he was done. And I know none of us will never forget Jerry Lee. None of us will. And he'll always be a strong influence in my life. And every decision I make, it's a kind of a tough role to try to follow here. I don't know if that's the path I can take or not. I just keep going where I am. But I just want to say thanks for everybody coming out here and showing their respect. And love you, Jerry Lee.
Amen. Bye.
Sometimes our pasts are diffuse and we all go different ways. But sometimes we can all come back together and heal. And we like that. Robert, would you like to say a few words?
I guess the most important words are, thank you, Jerry. Anyway, I'm in Portland when I get the news from Joanne. So I go up to the bar, order 3 shots of tequila. I was with my lady and her brother, and we're drinking to Jerry, and I immediately realized there's a lot of tequila being drunk right now for Jerry.
What?
And so my lady says, well, say something about Jerry. And the first thing that comes to mind is, he made a lot of people happy. And this juice comes from Portland as fresh as it can be. Poetry, because Jerry certainly was a poet. Sometimes shining, others come darken. Eat a hole through life. I know I do sometimes. Eat parts of other light. Crazy. Come, make our resistance to this. Absurd, eat, eat. Cut each other up. Drinking to no fill. Dimming by resenting any light but our own. Damn it. We are jealous. Proliferating madness. How do we get back to sane? Continuing this saga takes courage. Calls upon light. Oh, hatred, beware of this. Thank you very much.
Well, before we hear from family members, we'd like to close out this section of our tributes with the third leg of this impossible stool called Ray and Jerry and David. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. David Ballard.
A toast. Ding dong. The mean old man in the woods is dead. Unfortunately, Jerry embraced that term more than any of us ever thought. I regretted it when I first called him that, when he was first cutting his yard out of the jungle, as he would call it, over there when we first bought the Blue Moon. I told him just a few years ago, if I'd known he was going to live up to it so well, I never would have called him that in the first place. And live up to it he did. I'm sure that any of us who spent any real amount of time with Jerry ended up going toe to toe with him more than twice. Hey, I'm just speaking the truth, as Jerry would say. Yes, I know there's a lot of mixed emotions. Jerry was a lot of things to a lot of people. He could be a hard man to love, but look at you all. Here you are. How do you feel? There's a lot of love out there.
There's nothing but love.
And why?
Hallelujah.
Why? Why do you think? He was a hard taskmaster.
Yes.
But he was a great teacher. He was an inspiration to many of us. Did you learn anything?
Hallelujah, we have.
He was a master showman.
Yes.
I know a bunch of us.
Yes.
Were lucky enough to share the stage with him, and the rest of us got to really enjoy him on the stage playing all his various characters. You know, he lived and breathed it more than anybody I ever knew. He was just incredible.
Yes, sir.
He was a wonderful storyteller. And he never, ever let the truth stand in the way of telling a good tale.
Hallelujah!
Jerry always said, I'm a community man. And you know, he really was. He helped a lot of people. A lot of you out here, including myself, when we needed a little hand financially, Jerry loaned us some money, helped us out.
With interest.
Don't miss one payment.
Sexually.
The night before he died, I got to spend a little bit of time alone with Jerry, and he said, oh no, I just don't know what's going to happen to the Blue Moon when I die, David. And he looks at me and says, nobody thought we could last more than 6 months. And look at us, it's almost 20 years coming up. But he asked me to promise that we keep the spirit of the Blue Moon alive. And I said, well, you know, you're a hard act to follow. But we've got Jason, the apple don't fall far from the tree, Lee, coming in. Sorry, Jason. And I told him, along with Jason, Ray and I would do the best we could. Of course, in order to do that, we do need the community. We need all you folks. Jerry loved everybody here. He had a difficult way of showing it sometimes. But I hope whenever you can, you'll come on down here at the New Year's, join us. We hope this year might be the biggest and best one ever. Celebrate Jerry's life. And like the minstrels say, if you're ever traveling south on 75, well, you know where we are. Just listen to the song, it'll get you here. Come on in and share a few tales. One of the things that I admired most about Jerry, and I think actually one of the things that especially in his later life, he was most proud of, was his poetry. And I think Jerry was an absolutely brilliant poet. I'd like to read you a poem of Jerry's from a book called On the Shoulders of America in Search of the On-Ramp, a selection of poetry by Jerry Lee, the Monkey Man. Notice how I used the beer as the microphone. As I said, Jerry is a hard act to follow, and you know what? As much as I love the way he wrote poetry, the way he performed it was absolutely incredible. And, you know, folks, I'm not going to be able to do it like Jerry did, but when I read these words, I can hear some of his inflections, and I'm going to do my best, as Jerry would say, to do him proud. To you, my brothers and sisters, who share in the struggle, the agony and ecstasy of touching people's souls, we don't share the same background. We don't all call God by the same name. We share the touching, the healing, the feeling, the special heart of the universal stage. Out there blowing our horn, out there so far gone we could be blowing alone. The poetic lilt, the crucial rhythm, the touch of fire, when we share the dream, boundling, blasting, everlasting color in a world of shadows. Let our children take it home in their hearts to feel the glow, the fierce pride of embracing the joy and peace and pain that is life. Thank you, my brothers and sisters, for allowing me to share that price. Thanks and praises. We're going to liven up things a little bit.
Yeah.
We're going for a little bit of cacophony here. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Mr. Jason Lee.
Great to see everybody out here today. I'm gonna try and make it through this. I needed a little help. You did always say, start big, finish big, and keep them interested in between. You probably also said, don't read off a piece of paper. All right, we're gonna start out. This is gonna be a little crowd participation at the end. I'm gonna ask everyone here to be a part of it. At the end, when you get your cue, and I'll let you know what it is, and you'll know what it is. I want everybody to stand up and flourish.
Oh, Lord, I can't
and woolly bully amen for my dad.
I can't.
Why would I do that?
Shoes on, Todd.
Pony leg. Okay. Enough from you, from the peanut gallery here. All right, I talked to David and Ray and a lot of other people about this, and everybody thought it would be a good idea, so I'm going to go ahead and do this. And please remember that the spirit that this is intended, but I mean, we all know my father, right?
Yeah.
Son of a...
And we all know he was an asshole, right? But like, you know, everybody here who knew my father, I'd like you to raise your hand. I'd like you to put your hand down if he was never an asshole to you. Hey. Keep them up. You know who you are. Take a good look at these people. These are the people that worked for my father. These are his closest friends. These are his family. There's a reason. There's a reason we're all here. I can say with equal pride that my father was in prison and the circus. I still have trouble admitting to people that he was involved with the Renaissance fairs there. My father was a true inspiration. Internationally unknown and totally unfamous. It was not only the motto of the Rainbow Traveling Show, but a way of approaching life. Well, making money was always nice. Money did come later. It was the applause and the juice of the road that drove Jerry Lee to take the risks and to do the things that he did. My father did a lot of things in those early days to keep the show on the road. You have to have the ding. The ding keeps the monkey fed. Every day held a new adventure, even if that adventure was figuring out how to feed 3 to 10 people that day. I never knew my father to back down from a challenge or a challenger, for that matter. And the man always had a plan. Internationally unknown and totally unfamous indeed. I've never met anyone who could get more people to do more work for less money than my father. A true Tom Sawyer, if there ever was one. For any of you that think you won an argument with my father, I would like to remind you that that is your opinion. Some of my fondest memories are of playing games my dad invented and playing them with him. I'm talking about the board games to which only he knew all the rules. He never took it easy on me and beat me every time. Later in life, when I did my time on the road with old world games, I did beat him at the game.
Okay.
Only by turning everyone against it. I did that in the business too, actually. Yeah, well. He was never a gracious loser. I'd have beat you had y'all ganged up on me. All of us here today are a testament to a life well lived and friends well made. When I was like 16, I guess, I spent a summer on the road with my dad, and we did a lot of things that summer. It was right when he had first gotten on to the Renaissance fairs, and we ended up in Bristol, and we did a lot of things. One of the things we did that summer was we went to the National Rainbow Gathering in North Carolina that year.
Oh, my God.
And a lot of you here were there.
Are you rainbow people too?
And the one thing I always remember about that is the whole way there, every campsite we stopped in, every side of the road place we stopped at, he talked about what we were doing, that there's this gathering of the people and it was free and blah, 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 blah. And that was so great what we were doing. And as soon as we got there, fucking hippies. He turned. He did nothing but talk shit about the whole thing the whole time we were there. And I don't know how many of you have been to a rainbow gathering, but the big deal is July 4th. That's where everybody's quiet and gives back rubs or whatever it is they do, because we left that day. Drove our asses right out while they were having their silent whatever. So he certainly was a devil's advocate. He could take any side of an argument as long as he came out on top. As long as we all understand that he was right. Just a week or so ago, I picked up Randall Thompson on a midnight run to spend time with my father before he passed away. And Randy got in the car to drive the second leg through the night while I slept in the back. I said to him, "Now you know he's just going to be shitty to you the whole time you're here, right?" He said, "Yeah." And I said, "Let's go." Randy stayed up all night with my dad, thanks to the cocaine that my father lost. I could have sworn you said you found that last night. No, not me. So anyway, I got a little sidetracked. We're at this fucking rainbow gathering, right? And I'm on the LS crazy for the first time, and my dad did some himself. And I come into the trailer, and he's huge and mythical, and sitting in the monkey trailer, in the old circus truck, surrounded by monkeys. And he's holding two red chopsticks in his hand, and he looks at me very seriously. I mean, he knows I'm tripping. "My son, take this red chopstick." His jacket is way too small. "Take this red chopstick." "Take this red chopstick, my son. Travel the world. And when the red chopsticks are reunited, something, something, something." So I took my red chopstick, and it was years before I saw him again. And it was when I came out after college to come out on the road and work for him. Actually, I came here to go to graduate school, but he talked me out of that, and I ended up on the road. And I went back. I had my red chopstick, and Father, yes, I'm here to reunite the red chopsticks. Hallelujah. "What the fuck are you talking about?" So there you go. There's the red chopstick story. Just a little more here, and we'll get back to the music. We might even blow something up. Yeah. Final death indeed, right? Ah,
yeah. Final death.
To the death.
Okay. "Passionate and driven" is what this section is called. People can never be what we want them to be. After a period of being incommunicado with my father, fate brought us back together with my grandmother's passing. His first words to me, "Where were you for teardown?" We argued, I yelled, he stayed calm. I hated that. After the dust had settled, I realized that I did want a relationship with him. And after all, he is my father. I also realized that this relationship would have to be on his terms. I could live with that. Yes. All right, this is the rough part.
Do it.
I'm thankful for every minute I was able to spend with him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Lost my place. Thankful for every minute I got to spend with him. All right, there. And I don't regret how angry he would make me or how many times he hurt my feelings. I don't regret never having him tell me how proud he was of me, because maybe he was too proud himself. And I have heard from plenty of you how proudly he spoke of me.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
He did tell me he loved me often, and I know that he meant it. Last week when I held him in my arms,
come on.
And he told me he loved me. Although I make too many jokes at inappropriate times.
Got a lighter? All right.
I mean, we're calling in the clowns here for this last part.
Clowns are all cute.
Noses catch on fire.
It's bad.
I got nothing. I got one sentence left here. I'm just waiting for this.
For these clowns.
To quote Odin from a chat we had the other day, he left the bar high for us to live life beyond the ordinary, and we have a lot to live up to. Thanks for the sperm, Dad. That's your cue. Come on, one more. Thank you.
Bully,
bully,
amen.
There's a tree right above you, dude.
Everybody run! What the hell is he doing?
Ladies and gentlemen, the Blue Moonies!
Hey, thanks. Everybody here, we do want to say just one thing. We love you, Jerry, and also we stand here without a drummer. We love you, Gus.
Gus! Yes! Gus! Yes!
By the rivers of Babylon, where we sat down. Singing of a song in a strange land, by the rivers of Babylon, where we sat down, and there we went, when we remembered Zion, where the wicked carried. Thinking of a song in a strange land. So let the words of our mouths and the meditations of our souls be acceptable in my sight, oh, for I sat down. And there we went. When we remember the sun. This morning, smile with the rising sun. Three little birds by my doorstep, singing sweet songs, a melody pure and true. Singing,
this is my message to you.
Let's have a huge big old round of applause for the meanies.
The meanies!
The blue meanies. Can I have your attention, please? We're not quite done, folks. We have two more things that we're gonna try to pull off here. How many people here in the audience have come upon the blue moon and discovered a semi or completely naked Jerry Lee piddling in his yard? I know. Yeah, unfortunately, many of us had that experience. Well, we're going to do two things here, folks. We're going to give Jerry a permanent place or semi-permanent place on this land by planting him a tree. We're going to go over to his house, and Jason and Jamin are going to plant a palm tree in his behalf. And we're all going to sit around and water that tree with our hydrophasers.
Some of you can use your hydrophasers. I went with the
water. You go with fertilizer?
Next, after that, we're going to fill up balloons. There's a helium tank right on the porch there. And then once the tree is planted and the balloons are filled, we're going to make our way back over here and create a grand, what? Balloon Ascension!
So there was a debate whether or not we should burn it, keep it, or send it up with the balloon.